Hello, guys. So as you're sitting down, I'm going to introduce our next speaker. As I introduced myself last night, my name is Haley Smith from Concordia University, Irvine, and I'm an intern for the New Guard, YAFS online publication. Today, I had the pleasure of introducing one of my favorite YAFS speakers, Kate Obenshain. Kate Obenshain worked from 1995 to 2000 as an appointee for Governors Allen and Gilmore on the State Council of Higher Education for Virginia. After this, she was Virginia Senator George Allen's chief of staff and his chief education and health policy advisor. She made history as being the first female chairman of the Virginia GOP, serving from 2003 to 2006. In 2003, she founded the Jennifer Byler Institute as a leadership training program for young women in Virginia. And as many of you already know, she served as vice president of the Young Americas Foundation from 2008 to 2012. Her list of accomplishments don't stop there, though. Ms. Obenshain is the author of the book, Divider in Chief, The Fraud of Hope and Change, and has been the executive producer of two movies for YAF. She is frequently a guest on several different news programs and radio shows, and her writings have been featured in numerous prominent conservative outlets. Her other achievements include receiving the Young Americas Foundation's Torch of Freedom Award, as well as the Claire Booth Luce Policy Institute's Conservative Leadership Award. I can tell you that out of all the speeches I have heard sponsored by the Young Americas Foundation, Kate Obenshain is by far one of the most engaging and by far the most fun. So please, without any further ado, help me in welcoming Kate Obenshain to the stage.
Oh my gosh, I have to be the most engaging and the most fun. That is so much pressure. Hi, everybody. Welcome. It's so good to see you guys here. There is nowhere that I would rather be speaking than at a Young Americas Foundation conference, because you guys are it. You are on the front lines of the battle for freedom right now. And if you all aren't standing up and aren't championing liberty, ain't nobody else going to be doing it. We are counting on you. I am so happy to see so many young women here. Ron Robinson knows. I love looking at those pictures from the 70s. I mean, maybe three women, maybe four at the YAF conferences. It was hilarious. But now look at you. I think, oh, somebody just said they think over half of the participants are women. So way to go. Awesome. And I will tell you, it's incredibly hard, as you young women know, or as you will know after this conference, because after this conference, y'all are going to be throwing aside all of your reservations, all of your timidity, and you are going to be standing up for what you believe in. But you young women are going to face some of the toughest challenges for doing that, because you all represent the greatest threat to liberalism and its control over our country. Because once women figure out that liberalism is a myth, is a lie, in terms of what it can do for you, then women are going to be flocking to conservatism. Once women realize what a huge fraud radical feminism itself, what a huge fraud it has been for you all and for your future, for what it's like on campus right now. Okay, this is not what I came here to talk about, but this is what I'm going to talk about now. Okay, so the radical feminist movement, of course, started on college campuses because you all are so malleable, they think, that they can just take your little brains and do whatever they want, which is what they do all the time. So the radical feminist movement started to supposedly stop the objectification of women, because they were being treated as sex objects. All right, I just want you to think about what goes on college campuses right now. You girls, I don't mind calling you girls, I'm gonna call you girls, it's not an insult. You all know that guys don't ask you out for dates anymore. They just expect to get hooked up with. They expect you to put out. They do. That is thank you to the radical feminist movement that has fed you the lie that we are the same as men, and that we should just do the same things that men do. We're going to be happy and fulfilled. That is just not true. And now we see this thing happening. In the Washington Post last week, there was a story about the University of Virginia. And I'm sorry, this is all crass and crude, and I don't normally talk like this, but there's no choice. We're going to talk like this. So this freshman lacrosse player, guy, of course, guess guys play lacrosse, There was this, they went to this party. I know exactly where it is because I used to live there, Wortland Street. And they were walking around with the weed sprayers. We've never done this at school, where they spray the liquor. Hey, how are you? Where they spray the liquor right in your mouth. Everybody was trashed. I mean, completely trashed. I know you're shocked. I know, but they were trashed at this college party. So this girl was, she was still standing up. She was drunk. And she invites this freshman, this is really crude, but anyway, she invites this freshman lacrosse player into the bathroom. They, you know, have sex. She actually put the thing on him. And somebody's banging on the door saying, let me in. And she says, hey, give us a minute. We're not finished. Give us a minute. So, you know, she's voicing what she wants. The next day she woke up back in her apartment and said she felt uncomfortable. She felt like something wasn't right, like something had happened that shouldn't have happened. Well, no kidding. Of course she did. But of course, what she does is she goes and brings charges against this guy for sexual assault, even though it was a mutual thing. They were both drunk. But what my point is, that's a huge point. You guys need to be really careful. You gentlemen, it is not the way it, I don't know if it ever was, but it's not the way it used to be. If you have engage in relations with a girl, you better be darn careful because she can bring charges against you. And the Department of Justice has told colleges and universities, you start coming up with some more sexual assault convictions or we're going to cut your money. So they have a vested interest in finding you all guilty, whether there's any proof whatsoever or not. And they have your peers who have no experience and no business judging you casting judgments. That's another point. My point is about the radical feminist movement. Of course, these women are waking up the next morning saying, this is not the way it's supposed to be. Because men and women are profoundly different. They have profoundly different needs, profoundly different desires. And it's up to you all to set that standard for you young women to, hey, hold out for a freaking date, okay? And maybe even hold out for a second date. Go crazy. And maybe expect the guy to hold the door open. And, you know, we used to have, Ron is back there looking at me like, are you going to get to your point? Okay, but we used to have gentleman training. We had a lunch where the boys at the AF conferences all went to the gentleman training and the girls all went to sort of, you know, it was fun to separate you guys for once. This is gentleman training because they don't do it anymore. So hold the daggone door open for the ladies and girls, expect them to. My daughter and I were, okay, I'm 47 years old and I should not be dating, but you just never know how life is going to work out. So I'm a single mom. I'm dating a wonderful man, but... And he's the best gentleman I've ever known. So I think he might even be watching this right now. So I hope he's not offended. So we're going out to dinner, and Lucy's coming with us, my daughter. And Lucy and Steve are in the car. And Steve looks around. And he's like, where's your mom? And Lucy said, she's standing right outside the door waiting for you to open it for her. Okay? Make the guys open the door for you. I know it was a little bit of an awkward moment. He always opens the doors for me. But I'm talking to you young ladies. Hold out and stand up for what is right and for the distinctions. Okay, that's not my point, though, here today. I know, I just went off on the tangent. I'm sorry, but it is important. Nobody else is going to talk to you guys about that. And I'm sorry, I'm not trying to be the church lady. I really want to talk about Donald Trump, though. So... Gosh, what a segue. I mean, oh boy, that's going to be a huge issue for him, by the way, but we all know that. Where was I? Okay, was last week not that? I was really depressed last week. I did not love the Republican National Convention. For one thing, if I saw one more woman with the ridiculous bright, you know, red, white, and blue stars things with the headband sticking up to here and thinking she looks great. Or, you know, the cowboy hats with all the, it was, seriously, no. With the flags and the bumper stickers on their hat, you know, with things sticking out. We got to worry about optics. And when people see the lady with the, you know, Mickey Mouse ear, the American flag, it does not go well. For millennials, so yeah, they did this big, everybody held up. I'm a Republican, even though this is not political. So I'm not bashing Republicans because I don't like them. I love them, but I hate the optics because that's not who we are. They held up these signs that said millennials for Trump, and they misspelled millennials. Really? It was so embarrassing. So I just found it kind of a depressing week. Full disclosure, I was, gosh, this is going to turn off over half of you, but don't hate me. Let's just work together here. I was probably a Rubio fan to begin with because I was very skeptical for all of you who hate him because of the immigration thing. I get that. I disliked him for a couple of years because of that. I just thought that his message was the most appealing. He was the most electable. In a way, I thought he was pretty Reagan-esque, if you listen to what he says. I mean, it proved he didn't come through. Trust me, he didn't come through. I know that. Although I do think he fell on his sword to see that Donald Trump was not elected when he started running around sort of being the pit bull. I thought he knew. He was done by then, and he was willing to lose it. Then I was for Ted Cruz. Now I am very, I'm sorry, guys, I am very begrudgingly for Donald Trump. If the election were held today, I know y'all don't know how to react to that, I know. If it were held today, I would absolutely vote for Donald Trump because I'll be darned, and I'd like to use stronger language, I'll be damned if I do anything in my life to help Hillary Clinton become president of the United States. Oh my gosh. But it is tough. Last week was tough for me to watch, oh my gosh, Teal talk about stupid wars and the fake culture war. There really is a culture war. And it's not fake, but to watch the people in attendance, you know, they don't really know what to do because this guy he sounds like a Democrat. And then to see, is it Ivanka? Is the daughter's name Ivanka? Is that right?
Yeah.
Oh my gosh. Listening to her was very painful for people like me because I've been running around the country for about 20 years talking about the myth and the lie of that wage disparity between men and women. If you take into account the jobs we choose and how many years we take off to raise our family, our choices, there is virtually no wage gap. Okay, and then you have at the Republican National Convention, supposedly a conservative event promoting conservative ideals. Yeah, I know. Completely undermining so much of what we believe in, and then talking, and then Donald. As he moved on, I liked some of the stuff that he was saying, but he never once mentions limited government. Smaller government, the role of the individual, the need of government to get out of the way to unleash the full potential of you and me. I know when he said, I want to be your voice, Twitter lit up and all these conservatives saying, oh, I love that, it's beautiful. Thank you very much. I want to be my voice. I do not want. That's what conservatism is all about. It's about the bigger the government, the smaller the individual. And when the individual is tiny, you need this big, strong federal government speaking for you. We believe in stronger government at the local level so that you and I can have an impact in that. We don't want anybody solving all of our problems. We want to be able to solve them closer to the local level. Yes, I think he'll be tougher on terrorism, certainly, than any Democrats. I hate his stuff on trade. I can't stand this. We will not allow companies to go abroad. What I would have liked is for him to say, we will encourage companies to stay here by reducing what is currently the high, is it the highest or the second highest? Corporate, the highest now. Japan lowered theirs. So the highest corporate tax rate in the world. We will eviscerate that tax rate. We will lower it so dramatically that businesses will have no choice but to stay here because they will absolutely make a profit. We can't force companies to do things by which they won't make a profit. We kill the companies. We kill American jobs. We kill our tax base. It was a stunning argument to me. So I have a lot of problems. So my I know I do have a lot of problems, but my point is that this is a very, what I want to talk to y'all about is standing up for what you believe in and championing your principles, but this is a very tough time to be telling you that because arguably the standard bearer for conservatism in a lot of people's eyes is Donald Trump. And that is what really worries me. And that is why I think it's more important than ever that we have people like you who understand what conservatism is to be out there vocally championing what you believe in. I really think it does conservatism itself, the notion of limited government, increased individual liberty, I think it does it a disservice. I think it's almost dangerous for our great talk radio hosts out there, many of whom they're good friends of mine, I adore them, to be just in this love fest with Donald Trump. I think it's fine for them to support them and say, we can't have Hillary Clinton as president. But we've got to be honest about the fact that he is not a conservative. He will be better than Hillary, but he's not a conservative. Otherwise, you have a generation of young people coming up saying, oh, this is conservatism? Like, no. I mean, if that's conservatism, we can kiss our founding principles goodbye, because he really is. Rush Limbaugh, who I adore, and I do not put in the camp of blindly supporting Trump, but he said, somebody called in the day after Trump's speech, a Cruz fan, and said, I can't believe him. He never talks about the Constitution. He never talks about smaller government. And Rush was very clear. He said, that is because he does not believe in smaller government, period, end of sentence. You know, that's heartbreaking for me because I'm going to be casting my vote for him. But it's important to make that distinction. So I think that what I'm hoping that you all will do is be courageous advocates for true conservatism. Yeah, in a non-political setting, and this is not a non-political setting, but when you go back and you work with the college Republicans or whomever, work for the candidate you believe in. Work for the most conservative candidate. I'm all for that. But we got to look beyond that as well and not let our principles die. Now, I think my goal always is to encourage you to be courageous defenders of liberty. I think there is a big difference between being courageous defenders of liberty and critics. Everybody is a critic now. And critics are folks that sort of sit on the sideline and they tweet a lot of invective, a lot of name calling. I love Murray Kempton wrote, a critic is someone who enters the battlefield after the war is over and shoots the wounded. That is so true. It's just people that are sitting comfy on the sidelines looking at everything that's happening and saying, oh, he's an idiot, oh, he's a moron, blah, 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 blah. You really don't have much credibility to be sitting in your mom's basement, not you guys, but you know, these like 45-year-old men sitting there, you know, writing these nasty blog posts when they've never engaged ever. They've never put themselves out there except behind the anonymity of a tweet or a blog. What I'm hoping is that you all have the guts to put yourselves out there. Now, I'll tell you, I was way more engaged a few years ago. I was on Fox News, MSNBC. That was so unpleasant, but I did it anyway. I mean, even the makeup people were rude and hateful to conservatives, but I did it anyway, and I had to pull back because my family stuff got kind of out of control. I have a son who had a lot of challenges with addiction and that sort of thing, so I've pulled back, and I have to tell you, that part, the getting out of the conflict, has been lovely. Not having to be on the front lines and having to put myself out there and take the bullets, the verbal bullets, every day, the nastiness that comes our way, it's been great. I've been able to say, oh, I'm sorry, I can't get involved right now. I'm going to have to sit back and you all take care of it. My point is, I get how comfortable it can be on the sidelines and how luring it can be. But other than for little moments of crises in our life, we don't have that luxury. We have to be engaged. We have to commit to the battle. Otherwise, who in the world is going to stand up for what we believe in? I mean, you look at Hillary Clinton, and you look at the type of leader she would be, and the sort of leadership that she would bring to the White House. And I know other people are probably listing for you Hillary's deficits, and you all already know them. Obviously, the Clinton Foundation, you all, if everybody here doesn't order Clinton cash when you go home, something's wrong. You've got to get that. I don't know Is Young America's giving them that book, Ron? Ah! Peter Schweitzer owes me big. Okay, so you got to read the book Clinton Cash because it is verbatim the arguments that you need to be championing Donald Trump, because it's really, I think that's how you have to do it. But the Clinton Foundation, oh my gosh, it's pure graft. While she was Secretary of State, she would, there was no bidding on contracts. In Haiti, when they were rebuilding Haiti with billions of dollars, contractors did not come and competitively bid. They gave donations to the Clinton Foundation. And then they built their hurricane-proof mobile trailers in Haiti. They got millions and millions of dollars when they were completely inept at what they were doing. And then, of course, they give Bill Clinton lucrative hundreds of thousands of dollars, sometimes $700,000 speeches. That was the Ukrainian, that was the Russian deal with our uranium, where they gave 20% of our stockpile of uranium to Russia because this guy gave Bill Clinton a speech for $700,000. You got to read this book so that you can argue far more eloquently than I just did, but you got to argue the graft that Hillary Clinton engages in. For Pete's sake, the Clintons stole $200,000 in China furniture and artwork when they left the White House. To me, they should be in jail for that. I mean, they stole it and they had to return it. Oh, I'm so sorry. Did we take that painting? Did we take that huge China service? Yeah, it's amazing to me. These people are out for themselves and they are out for money and that is it. Obviously the emails, and obviously for me, I mean, Donald Trump could be a lot worse because it was that, for me to support him, because it was that moment. I don't know if y'all remember it, but Barack Obama and Hillary Clinton were standing there on the tarmac, and literally the four coffins were next to them of the brave men who died in Benghazi. They were right there, the four coffins, and they stood there with straight faces, except this fake grief painted on their face. It was so disgusting. And they stood at that podium and they talked about the fact that these men died because of a movie. Because of a movie. Not because of terrorism, because of course they had conquered terrorism. And that was the narrative that Barack Obama and Hillary Clinton had to keep going. So he lied. They lied. She stood up there too and said the exact same thing, even though we knew that attack had nothing to do with that stupid internet movie. It was terrorism. It was plotted. It was planned. They had been begging for reinforcements. But in order to continue their narrative, they lied while these coffins were right there next to them. To me, we don't need any more arguments for why we need to stand up against Hillary Clinton. But what we really need to be standing up for is our own individual freedom and our own individual liberty. And the presidential election aside, you all have this amazing opportunity to do that right on your college campus. And I beg you to do it on your campus, but then after that, don't stop. The campuses this week, and when you go back to your school, this is training ground for the rest of your lives. Of course, what you do on campuses is incredibly important, and the obstacles are enormous. You've got intimidation from your leftist professors. You stand up there, they're expecting you to walk in line with them, to just mutely follow and not to interrupt, not to argue. So it's and then your leftist fellow classmates are putting a lot of pressure on you to be quiet. You're also inclined probably not to stand up and say what you believe in because of this crazy notion that you can't do it until you know everything. That, oh, just give me a little while longer to perfect my argument on such and such, and then I'll stand up in my history class, or good grief, it could be math. They put liberalism into everything before I'm going to stand up and say what I believe in. So we wait. I think we conservatives in particular are kind of perfectionists about that sort of thing. Then you've got this lovely call on college campuses for civility. You know, we believe in diversity and freedom of speech, but we want it to be civil. We want everybody to be kind and nice. And you're like, oh, well, that sounds great. Okay. It's not great. It's horrible. It's calls for civility is the left attempt to silence you. And we're so daggone nice. Look at all of you. You're so nice And we're like, okay, I won't do it. That's what those stupid speech codes are. And the speech zones where they have this little circle or square in the middle of your state-supported campuses. And they say, well, you stand inside that circle or square and you say whatever you want. You have your First Amendment rights. But you step outside that circle or square and you are bound by our speech codes. Well, that is unconstitutional. And for goodness sake, where else are we supposed to have the vibrant, free exchange of ideas than a college campus? You're supposed to be a little bit uncomfortable every now and then. You're absolutely, if you get insulted, you know what happens now? You all do know because you're there. They send you to the Bias Incident Review Committee. If you've insulted somebody, the anonymous Bias Incident Review Committee, where anybody can put your name in. They had it at Wake Forest. There are a bunch of other schools where they have it. They put your names in, and there is a committee that will investigate you because of an anonymous allegation that you hurt their feelings. That's nuts. These are college campuses where we're supposed to be arguing for Pete's sake. And if somebody has a really stupid or even an evil idea, freedom allows you all to be able to challenge that idea. But when we're shut down, we can't challenge ideas. You know, leftists on campus think this is great, think speech codes are great. They're going to think it's great until their ideas are silenced. And there will come a time, because it keeps encroaching on individual liberty and on individual speech. So it's all great when it's somebody else's ideas that are shut down. But college campuses should be battlegrounds for ideas. Just these factories for great ideas, but they're not anymore. Of course, being different is an inhibitor. We all hate to be different. We hate to stand out, so we hate to say something that other people are going to disagree with because we stand out. And you went through elementary and middle and high school trying desperately not to stand out. And then here I am asking you not only to stand out a little bit, but everybody on your campus is probably going to know who you are. And they're probably, half of them are not going to like you. But the funny thing is, there are a lot of them who will agree with you. And you might not know it when you stand up and raise your hand in that class. But I'd say every 6 months, I get an email from somebody who's come to these YAF conferences. And they say, Kate, I remember when you said, for Pete's sake, raise your hand in that class and say what you believe. And you might think you are the only person in there who believes it. And people will come to you afterwards. They will say, hey, I really agree with you. You know, I agree with what you said. Thanks for saying it. And then more and more people will come to you and say, yeah, I agree with you. And they'll start raising their hands and they'll start saying something. It's this incredible effect where your one demonstration of courage can encourage other people to step out of the bounds of political correctness that have you all chained together on college campuses and say what you truly believe. I think as you start to stand up, I know after this conference, you guys are going to have the guts to step out. Those of you who haven't already, some of you I know are here because your parents or your grandparents probably forced you to come. Or some of you just because you wanted to have a, I know you're looking at each other like, yeah. Or because you wanted to party for a week. I don't know what it is. Some of you are true believers and you came here to learn more about conservatism. There we go, on the front row. All right, true believers. But I hope that at the end of this conference, maybe you won't be ready to completely fall on your sword, but maybe you'll be willing to raise your hand and just say to your professor, hey, you know, I have a little problem with that. That's huge. Just one person saying that. Now, how do you take that first step and how do you stand up for what you believe in? Well, first of all, you do it and you don't wait. You don't wait for that perfectionism. I hope that you do it respectfully. I love Ann Coulter, and I love our bomb throwers out there, our intellectual bomb throwers. I think they're fabulous because they achieve a certain purpose. They get things going. It's not always very pretty. But I don't think it's incredibly effective for you and me to be out there insulting people. I don't think we bring a lot of people over to our perspective. Maybe we get people talking, but I think we win more people over when we're respectful. I don't think, oh my gosh, who? Trey Gowdy gave the commencement address at Liberty University, and I saw it on Facebook the other day. Please go look that up. That was one of the best speeches I have ever heard, and he talks about how to effectively champion your ideas and how to bring others over. I love Trey Gowdy anyway, but that was an incredible, incredible speech. So I wouldn't be calling people idiots. That's what made me think of it. He used that example. I wouldn't do that. I think you need to watch your audience. Like, I'm watching you guys now, and some of you people over there are yawning, so I got to get going. You have to watch your audience and make sure that they're captivated. Sometimes we conservatives can drone on about our philosophy, particularly if you're a total wonk and you just love facts and figures and ideas. That's probably not going to bring a lot of people over either. Speak in the terms that your contemporaries understand. Be current. You got to watch the news. You got to read a few editorials. You don't have to become completely proficient, because I realize you are actually in school, but watching the news is probably a good idea. I don't do the seek and destroy. I would suggest a smile. You have to look nice. I know you're like, what? No, seriously. And it helps if you look nice. That's so offensive, I'm sure. But people sometimes would love me on Fox News. They'd be like, oh my gosh, I loved everything you said, but your hair looks super. Or you smiled so nicely. I love what they did with your makeup. Okay, and that seems so stupid, but they're receptive to me if I'm smiling. And I often rolled my eyes. That's not very good either. But if we smile and we're appealing and we're likable, I mean, you gotta win your crowd over on a personal level. First, if they hate you, they're gonna wanna hate your ideas. So if you go, then you're never gonna win them over. So smile, do all that. Don't, like I just did, well, never mind, okay. Be courageous is the number one thing, because otherwise you're never, ever going to get out there and stand up for what you believe in. And I think, you know, we think about, gosh, I really am intimidated, and does it really matter? And what's the big deal? People are going to think I'm a nut job. I'm a flag-waving fanatic. Well, for good grief, just think about some of the flag-waving fanatics in our history. And if it weren't for those flag-raising, flag-waving fanatics way back a couple hundred years ago, we would not be sitting here. We would not be having this free and open discussion. If it weren't for a little, what was his name? 5 foot, who's the guy? John Paul Jones. Did somebody say that? You got that from 5 foot? Okay, John Paul Jones, when he was fighting in the revolution against the world's greatest military power, the greatest navy on the face of the planet. He's in this little sinking ship, and the British commander yells over, I mean, it's sinking, literally. And he yells over, are you ready to surrender? And awesome John Paul Jones says, I have not yet begun to fight. And he ended up winning in this barely seaworthy vessel. He ended up winning. We have so many of those stories of great American heroes who were willing to be slightly fanatical. I mean, every single one of our founding fathers, every single one of the 56 who were willing to sign the Declaration of Independence were freaking fanatics, because they were going to lose. And when you think about them, you know, we think the revolution, the tri-corner hats, it was all beautiful and fun and kumbaya, and yeah, we were going to win anyway. They were absolutely going to lose. If you guys don't know your Revolutionary War history, you got to learn it, because that is all the inspiration you will ever, ever need. And we don't know anything about these 56 signers of the Declaration, but they were one example of selfless courage after another. For the most part, they were all wealthy and they had so much to lose. It wasn't like they had nothing and they're just going to throw it all to the wind and go for it. They had families, they had wealth, they had prosperity, and yet they were willing to put their signature on what was their death warrant. If America lost, they would surely be hung, they would die, because there was no way Britain was going to let them win, live. But every single one of them were willing to go and put their names on this document, and every one of them suffered mightily. 9 died during the war from wounds or hardship. 5 were captured and made examples of by beating and starvation. Their sons, when captured, they bore the absolute worst of it. Two of their wives were captured and thrown into prison and tortured. Every single one of the signers of our declaration were hunted down and chased from their homes. Many lost their homes and their fortune. There's John Hart from New Jersey. Knowing that his home was being watched, he tried to return one night to be there with his dying wife. Hessian soldiers chased him into the woods. He was 65 years old. He lived in caves. They destroyed his home. When he finally returned, his wife was dead and his 13 children were gone. He never saw them again. Abraham Clark is my favorite example of true courage, of one of the signers of the Declaration. He was, his two sons were captured and they were put on those floating death ships, the prisoner of war ships off of the coast, but everybody died practically on those prisoner of war ships. And Abraham Clark was captured and he was told by the British, if you will but recant your signature on the Declaration of Independence, if you will do that, we will let your sons go free. Can you imagine what it cost him to say the word no and to watch his boys die? Because he believed in something bigger than himself. And that is the key to being able to just raise your hand in a class that is dominated by leftists and by this tyrannical leftist lecturing you from the podium. To believe in something bigger than yourself. For me, it's freedom. But I know that sounds so dorky, but it really is. It's not dorky at all. It's noble and good. And I know a lot of you believe in the same thing. But to believe in something bigger than yourself. So if I believe in freedom, and if I look to the example of George Washington and Thomas Jefferson, our founding fathers, am I really going to crumple when somebody calls me a name because I like Sarah Palin? Or, you know, how crazy am I? You know, because I champion Ronald Reagan, and yeah, I want another Ronald Reagan, okay? I do. Is that crazy? No! Of course we want another Ronald Reagan. But if I and you believe in something bigger than ourselves, then who cares? And Margaret Thatcher used to say, I always love it when they start throwing personal attacks at me because I know they have not a single political argument left. You know you've won when they start throwing the invective and name-calling at you because they just don't have anything else to say. And you will find that on college campuses like this. The minute you stand up, they're never challenged because the opposition is shut down starting in high school, middle school, grade school, for Pete's sake. Global warming, good grief. So they don't say a word. And when you actually challenge them, their faces blanch. They get this look on their face like, oh my gosh, what do I say now? And they'll say, oh, you're an idiot. That's what they will say. Oh, you're an idiot. And you're like, okay, fine. But I also believe this, 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 and this. What do you think? What do you think? Is that a reasonable argument? They have a hard time coming back at you when you stand up and you articulate what you believe in. I want to just close telling you this story that I tell every time, and those of you who have heard me before, like, enough already, but everybody, I always have these people come up and say, oh, I had this darling girl come up, wherever we were, Ron, oh, Tennessee, and said, oh, I love that story about that guy that you told, like, Patrick Henry. Yes, that guy. So obviously Patrick Henry, not everybody knows who he is, but I'm obsessed with Patrick Henry and our founding fathers. I named my first son after Patrick Henry. He's Henry. He's Richard Henry. Richard Henry was the first signer of the Declaration. I sort of have forced my children to memorize the Give Me Liberty or Give Me Death speech. I think all of them. Maybe Lucy has not memorized it yet. But that's how much I believe in Patrick Henry. Because when he stood up in 1775 at St. John's Church in Richmond, Virginia, people were not on his side. He was in the absolute minority at that time when he was championing the notion of liberty from Great Britain. I'm sure Thomas Jefferson and George Washington were probably thinking, maybe this is a little premature here, buddy. Tone it down. But he didn't. He stood there and he thundered in St. John's Church. And I've loved that example. It has given me great courage and great enthusiasm my whole life. So a couple years ago, I was speaking for a nonprofit group, and I was talking about tax increases. I don't remember what exactly was going on, but I was traveling all over Virginia that day. It was a day like today. It was hotter than Hades, and this was my fifth speech of the day, and all I wanted to do was go home. And I had to go to Richmond and give yet another speech, another two-hour drive home. I was ticked. And I almost skipped it. I was like, why am I having to do this? Why am I having to talk about liberty again? Aren't there other people who can do this? I got a family, really. I got to get home. So I'm sweating. I am miserable. I am driving into Richmond. I grew up in Richmond. And yet I drive into this part of Richmond I have never seen before. Never. And that was back when Richmond was the murder capital of the country. So I was slightly terrified. I mean, it was a rough part of town. So I'm locking the doors and going through red lights to just get me where I need to be. Let me get this stupid speech over with and get home. So I come to a stoplight, and I actually stop at the stoplight. And I'm looking around, and I'll never forget, right there on my right-hand side is St. John's Church. And I gotta tell you, it hit me like a ton of bricks. What hit me was this incredible gift of liberty that you and I have been given. And I thought about Patrick Henry and what he was willing to sacrifice when he stood on that floor. And they say the rafters actually shook as Patrick Henry committed pure and absolute treason when he said, "Is life so dear or peace so sweet as to be purchased at the price of chains or slavery? Forbid it, Almighty God. I know not what others may do, but as for me, give me liberty or give me death." And I will tell you, the tears rolled down my face because I was ashamed that I wasn't willing to do this little thing, give a speech for Pete's sake, encourage other people to stand up for freedom. I can do this. And you know what? You all can do this too. You can choose to have your head in the sand. You can choose to do nothing and hope to God that somebody else is willing to do something and defend your freedom so that you and your kids someday, way down the road, your kids might actually be able to be free. Or you can sit on the sidelines and you can be a critic because it's a lot of fun. I love live tweeting these Democrat things. I just love it. I have a blast. That is not courageous involvement in defending liberty, but it's fun. So go ahead and do that. But you can be the critic who just sort of sits back and tweets away. Or you can actually engage. You can be vulnerable and put yourself out there. And being vulnerable is actually an extremely courageous, magnificent thing. So you can put yourself out there to stand up for liberty. There is no better encouragement for not being a critic, but for actually engaging than Teddy Roosevelt's quote. I know you all know it, but go and memorize it. And I realized this morning I haven't memorized it. So that's when by next year I'll memorize it when I come back. When he said, "It is not the critic who counts, not the man who points out how the strong man stumbles or how the doer of deeds could have done them better. The credit belongs to the man who is actually in the arena, whose face is marred by dust and sweat and blood, who strives valiantly, who errs and comes short time and time again, because there is no effort without error and shortcoming. But he who actually strives to do the deeds, who knows great enthusiasms, the great devotions, who spends himself in a worthy cause, who at the best, in the end, knows the triumph of high achievement, and who at worst, if he fails, at least fails while daring greatly, so that his place shall never be with those cold and timid souls who know neither victory nor defeat." Do you really want to be with the cold and timid souls? You have got this one and only life. And I promise you, you have been put in this very room for this week for a specific purpose. My guess is it's because we, the American people, this country, need you. I am a firm believer that God has blessed our country. I also believe that freedom does not come from Barack Obama. It sure as heck doesn't come from our Supreme Court. It comes from the Almighty. And nobody has the right to take that freedom away except when we give it to the government in very limited portion. Well, let me tell you, the government has taken so much more of our liberty than we have given to it. But we need to do the hardest task ever, and that is take it back. A lot of times, a lot of the founders said, once liberty is gone, it is gone forever. So we have a Herculean task to get that freedom back, and we can't do it. Gosh, look at the bunch we have right now up there championing what we believe in. I love some of these guys. I think Paul Ryan's great. I think a lot of them are great, but they are not crusaders for liberty that are willing to be defeated and who are willing to sacrifice dramatically and personally to protect liberty. All I'm asking you all to do is when you go back to your campuses, start being champions for liberty. Raise your hand in class. Have a speaker, a courageous speaker, where yes, people are going to come after you because you had the audacity to bring Noni Darwish or Baby Cannon or, heaven forbid, Ann Coulter to your campus. Stand outside that free speech zone and say what you really think, even if it might offend somebody. And by saying America is the greatest country on the face of the earth, you will totally offend tons of people. So that's all you have to do. Stand outside that speech zone because it's your right to do that. In whatever way you see fit, stand up for what you believe in. And if you do, we'll be able to protect and save freedom. Thank you all so much, and God bless you. Okay, who's got questions? Come on up.
Hi, my name is Lindsay Gatzios. I'm from the University of Akron in Ohio. And I had a lot of teachers or professors like this, but there was one in particular. He was a very proud socialist. And whenever you would challenge him, and I did a lot, he didn't like me very much.
Good job.
He would do one of three things. He would yell that I didn't know what I was talking about.
He would actually yell?
Oh, he would blow up.
Nice. Okay.
He would say his piece and then say conversation over and not let me say anything. Or he would find a way to make the whole class laugh, so they thought it was a joke.
Right.
So, just wondering, how would you respond in the classroom in that instance?
Well, first of all, you don't need to. When he has to yell, and when he has to belittle, and when he has to say discussion over, you won. You totally, completely devastated him. And the people in that class, yeah, they'll chuckle at what his little joke, but I promise you, you have accomplished your objective. They are thinking about what you said, and that's all you want to do. You want to get them thinking, because a lot of times, your classmates have never heard conservative ideas before. As mind-blowing as that is, it is the stuff you're hearing this week, people have never heard that. A lot of students have never heard that. So you are introducing those ideas. The one thing I would also say, and you'll hear some speakers say that you should be careful about your grades. So be, you know, maybe you don't want to stand up for what you believe in because of your grades. Bull. That is such a cop-out. You say exactly what you believe. You write the paper as you believe it should be. And if they dare to give you a C when you deserve an A, you appeal and appeal and appeal until you get the grade you deserve. But do not let them shut you down because you're worried about your GPA. I think that that's an abdication to do that.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Hey, my name is Ben Bolton, and I'm from Alabama. Thank you for being here today, and I liked a lot of the stuff you had to say. But I have a question. I understand the severity of Hillary becoming president and your hatred for her.
I don't hate her.
Okay.
I love my country, though, and she should not be president.
I have a question. Do you not feel like you're giving up your own battle by casting your vote for Trump and merely critiquing him?
Okay, do I not feel I'm giving up my battle? You think I shouldn't vote for Trump because I'm not in love with him and all that he believes in, is that right?
Well, I understand like voting for the lesser of two evils, but I'm currently on the fence right now. I casted a different Republican ballot for the primary.
Yeah.
But just like giving up your battle for a smaller government and more personal freedom, do you not feel like you're giving in?
No, I don't. I feel like giving in would be not voting at all. And you will hear a lot of people say, I'm not voting. And you'll actually hear some speakers tell you, don't vote. I have a big problem with that because I do believe that in every single war, men and women have died to protect my right to cast a vote. And I think this is the hardest election I have ever had to cast my vote in. I have never been this conflicted trying to figure out what to do. But I am going to do the best I can with who I have. I'm not voting for Gary Johnson. I think he's rather a nut. And I'm going to... I thought about it. I really did, because some of his stuff is pretty good. I am sure as heck not voting for Hillary Clinton, because I care about the Supreme Court, and I think the Supreme Court is already so overstepped. Ruth Bader Ginsburg, really? I mean, could you believe her last week or 2 weeks ago? Yeah, purely partisan. That is where the Supreme Court's going to go. So I'm voting for Donald Trump because he's all I've got. And is that giving up? I fought hard during the primary. I supported my guy. I think if I hadn't done that, that would be giving up.
That would absolutely.
And I fought individually trying to convince people. Are you crazy with this notion? My son is a big Trump fan, just saying, ugh, it's so terrible, we need to throw it all out and start over, so why not? Let's bring him in. And I argue that's reckless. However, I truly get why Trump has taken off, and I think it is because the so-called conservatives that we have voted into office, they've run as conservatives, and they've governed as liberals. Not as moderates, but as liberals, indistinct from Democrats. That is why we are in this situation. So I'm very clear on that, and I think Trump is, I'm not going to say the lesser of two evils, but I'm going to say he's the best choice that I have among my options, so it's what I'm going to do.
Yes, ma'am. Do you see a possibility of our generation doing away with a two-party system?
No, I don't think so. I think the two-party system is still, personally, I think it's the way to go, because I don't like, for instance, in Britain, I think that they have much less individual impact on their parties. You read Daniel Hannan, he talks, Daniel Hannan, by the way, you got to pay attention to him and his Brexit stuff, it is so daggone cool. Brexit gave me hope for the first time in so long. The courage of the British people, and if you're like, what? The media is saying that we should be alarmed. No, it was awesome. It was courage. It was bringing individual power back to Great Britain. It was awesome. But no, I think what young people need to do is to take back the political process, bring true, courageous principles. Say what you believe and stand up for what you believe. If you're in this, if you're in politics because you want your picture taken with Mitt Romney or Ted Cruz or whoever, get out. You know, still stand up for what you believe in. But do not. This is not what it's about. We need people who believe in their ideals and who are willing to suffer for those ideas. That's what I'm counting on this generation to do. Thank you guys so much. God bless you.